Are people in Iraq and Iran watching videos of President Trump that are fake by somebody?
Possible.
Doing his voice.
Yeah,
and saying,
absolutely possible.
We need to keep firing away at Iran.
Oh, absolutely, because that's
like
what
that.
Iran does. Is always try to make you look bad as an American.
Right.
They always try to make you look like the enemy. So what they doing?
I want to see an Iranian dude doing a Trump accent. That's what I want to see.
It'd be gold. Because I will say this: the reason I bring this up, I saw the Putin one the other day, and it was real hard to distinguish if it was real or fake.
Yeah.
And I was just like, yeah. I knew it because of the article title, and they were like, hey, give this a watch. This is how close we're getting.
So if you look into Facebook, deepfake is basically, it works when you do it in English. However, Facebook do have employees who are supposed to do that for them when people speak Arabic or other languages. However, in the Middle East, we don't speak like Americans in English language, speaking like all the same kind of language that's kind of similar.
Idioms don't translate well. If you were to say, I don't have a dog in that fight.
Right.
Yeah. Or something like that. That doesn't mean shit to an Iraqi person. So.
And the other part is that we have different dialects. Dialects, which means it's almost a different language. So if let's say, if someone in Facebook is vetting this some other video, which it could be of an Iraqi politician that's trying to speak against Iran, or maybe they're faking something about some guy saying something about, they want to make someone look bad, or more of like defaming somebody.
Mm-hmm.
It works if the employee is from that country and knows that dialect, it works. If that person that Facebook has that's supposed to vet that video or supposed to recognize it is not from that country, just because if a Moroccan speaks, they can never understand me and I can never understand them. That's how it is. It's not like English where you can talk to an Australian and you can you talk to a Brit. It doesn't work this way.
Right.
So what they're doing is they learned that Facebook have a hard time distinguishing that, and they've been using this technique to actually go after their enemies in the media-wise, putting words that you didn't say out there to make you look bad. And even though Facebook has been doing a good job, every once in a while they're doing a campaign. They've been deleting a lot of pages. But as many pages that get deleted, as more as they make. Perhaps they're establishing 128 pages that most likely will do paid ads. But if the Iraqi channels pay those ads, it doesn't look anything. It's not against Facebook freedom of speech. It's not violence. It's not sexual. It's morally just news.
Yeah.
So the point of it is you might think it's just news. If you sit of it as Ross Peterson working for Facebook and you look at it, you'll be like, there's nothing wrong with this.
Yeah.
But the whole point of it, of that that ad or that video, is to get people actually to slowly build them towards hating America, hating the Middle East, showing them that what America is going to do to them. So you're talking about a new generation of Iraq that's going to come out, or new generation of Syria and Yemen and other countries are going to come out already automatically hating America.
So let me ask you this. No one at Facebook or the people that work at Facebook are Middle Eastern?
They do. They do. That's what I'm saying, is they do have Middle Eastern, but they might not have the right Middle Easterns. If you bring a Moroccan to try to figure something out that someone is in Iraqi speaking, I can give you 100% guarantee that person would never be able to figure that out.
You have to bring someone
who actually speak that dialect and understand it correctly and can know the words and know the personalities in order to know if that's a deepfake or if that's a real conversation. So that is something. Even though, like, I'm not saying Facebook doesn't know about this. It's unintentional, but they need to work harder.
Facebook isn't an intelligence organization, so they don't have a staff of translators for every single goddamn Arabic dialect.
Exactly,
there's no way they would.
Yeah.
I mean, why would they?
This just keeps getting worse and worse, doesn't it?
It's not going to stop. It just is what it is.
I know.
I mean, they're using the same thing we're using here for like our own elections or whatever, but they're using it for long term because they don't have election. You know what I mean? Like they control everything. Down there, they're using it for the long term, for the next 10 years. We need to fix this. We need to make sure the next generation is absolutely the way we want them to think. And perhaps the information I got, they said it's the most difficult job for the Iranian Revolutionary Guard right now. is to do this job.
I'm sure. Because this is the easiest, cheapest way to pass out information. Because you don't have to go. It's costly to send people out in the streets.
Yeah.
It's costly to fucking line people up and do all that other shit.
It's more than just, it's costly in ways other than financial as well.
Yeah.
Like there's political, like your economy suffers because of trade deals getting shut down and shit. But if you can just do shit in secret, I mean, this is what the U.S. has been doing for years. We used to, during the Cold War, one of my college professors, he was an Air Force intelligence guy, retired, obviously, told me that during the Cold War, they would fucking, they dropped these leaflets over parts of the former Soviet Union.
They used to do it in World War II as well, right?
Yeah, but it was like crazy stuff. They would drop leaflets that talked about Americans having bigger dicks and they put like a Magnum condom on it and drop them out of the just like it was a test to see if they cared about that, like if the women would start turning on their dudes and coming over to the U.S. side,
really,
because of bigger dicks. Like that's just one example. Wow. He told me a million of them. Like this is all this weird shit that we did back then in the Cold War.
Yeah,
but yeah, the U.S. has been doing this shit for years.
Oof.
It's not like I don't.
The difference is this though. We didn't have like 10 years ago. We didn't have social media. We didn't have YouTube was what just turned 15 years old. We didn't have YouTube. We didn't have in our generation, right? We do now, but for my kids and. Watching them come up, like all they use is YouTube, you know, TikTok, weird shit like that. And it's like, once you're able to control that, it's game over.
Well, I mean, look,
because trying to stop it as a parent,
I think the next generation after our kids, there's going to be some kind of rebellion against technology. I think because that's how it works. Like humanity is very cyclical when it comes to stuff like that. So.
You're right, by the way. I just had this conversation with Jesse.
I think it's
there's a
happen.
Group of kids right now who, what was it called in the Ross Patterson Revolution? Normcore is what it's called. Yeah. They're rebelling against these teenagers in America are rebelling against dressing up slutty or trying to look attractive. They're wearing mom jeans, those white thick sneakers like your aunt's wear. I mean, they look, and it's cute girls where you're just like, dude, you look horrific. They're not wearing makeup. They're not doing, it's like Billie Eilish wearing baggy clothes and shit like that. They're covering up and they're like, oh, we're fighting back against society. And it's like,
it's weird how that works. I mean, like with the more successful you become. We lived outside, had to hunt, fish, gather, etc., right? Fight off our enemies all the time. And now we live indoors and we do all those things for recreation.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So now we've the things that we I guess if you want to take it that direction, Fight Club, what does he say in that, and would Chuck Palahniuk write the things we own end up owning us?
Yeah.
Something like that. Yeah. Social media is definitely becoming like that. Like it's becoming it's a virus. It's too powerful and everybody has access to it. It's like just having a fucking it's like an open air office, right? And there's a fucking red button. But there's not even a line. You can just walk up and press it anytime you want.
Yeah.
Not that there's not even security. There's not even a goddamn line. You can walk over there and do whatever the fuck you want. You can press that button all day. And I feel like it's iRobot, Isaac Asimov. Like, what's the right question to be asking right here? Where is this all going? Like, what's the next threat that's going to, because, I mean, we think about the normal shit, like our energy infrastructure, power grid and all that stuff,
right?
And banking and fucking jails that are, I mean, like all these institutions that are controlled by computer systems, right? That have become a lot less secure because of social media and a lot more accessible because of it. And but we think about those kind of things. Those are obvious if you're a risk assessment person, but how do you imagine something that doesn't exist?